I was glad when they said unto me, let us go into the house of the Lord. Good morning, everyone.
Good morning.
It's so good to see you all in church today. Let's turn to 738 in our United Methodist hymnals, the blue hymnal, and we will be singing response number 2 and reading responsively Psalm number 1. Counsel of the wicked,
or stand in the way of sinners, or sit in the seat of scoffers.
But their delight is in the law of the Lord,
and on God's law they meditate day and night.
They are like trees planted by streams of water that yield their fruit in season, and their leaves do not wither.
In all that they do, they prosper.
Like a tree that's planted by the water, we shall not be moved.
The wicked are not so, but are like chaff which the wind drives away.
Therefore the wicked will not stand in the judgment, nor sinners in the congregation of the righteous.
For the Lord knows the way of the righteous,
but the way of the wicked will perish.
Like a tree that's planted by the water, we shall not be moved.
And now I ask that you turn into your hymnal to 110 and let us stand and sing one of the great hymns of the church, A Mighty Fortress Is Our God. Let us stand as able and sing.
Oh,
My own? Thank you. In celebration of Mother's Day, today we have flowers. These flowers, yay is right. These flowers are in honor of our mothers and mother figures who have been so important in our lives. You are invited to come forward if you wish. Take a flower, place it in a vase, and then speak into the microphone simply the name of the mother or mother figure that you would like to honor today. We lift, she is ready, just 1 minute. We lift these names up to God as an expression of our gratitude and our love. Please come forward.
Emily.
That was Emily.
Emily. Charlotte Thompson and Marion Oakley.
Kim and Jesse.
Donna Middle and Carol Peden.
Olive Davis.
Kelsey Gerhart.
Kelsey Gerhart.
You can speak.
Nancy Davis.
Irene Blessing and Lucille Chernikov.
Jeannie Edwards.
Mabel Butler.
Ellen Scammerhorn.
Darlene Robinette and Betty Sitting.
Fanny Gillum and Sue O'Ran.
Gwen Carmen and Helen Higgins.
Lorena.
Brenda.
Carol, Dorotha, and Clara.
Betty Jo Gentry and Marie Whitehouse.
Grandmother Allen and Bonnie and Mom.
Harriet Alley and Catherine Graham.
Doris Kaiser and Tilly Strobe.
Irene Eubanks and Mitch Stounce.
Cora Austin.
Helen Vance.
Marjorie Morgan.
Alfreda Grimm.
Carol Craig, Doris Dunbar, and Dorotha Meadows.
Janine Miner.
Barbara Sprinkle and Paula Miner.
Francis, Janie, Martine, and Brenda.
Irene Vandeventer Skinner, Lillian Vandeventer, and Lillian Skinner.
Sharon Leegers and Alex Leegers.
Barbara Jarrett.
Virginia Matthews and Sandra Matthews.
Elizabeth Newsom and Lottie Craig.
Gina Davis.
My mother, Joanne, and her mother, Grace.
Norma Jean Higdon Ice.
Nola Altoona Madeline.
And Gyneth.
Lillian and Lucille.
Madeline.
Myrna. My mother, Nola Catherine. My wife, Margaret. And the rest of the girls in my family, all six of them.
Rebecca Penland, Betty Rickey.
I drew a blank, can you believe that? Yes. Bev Salmon, Jesse Weatherholt, Farrell Martin, Maggie Zoff.
What a joy it is to celebrate our mothers and those who have filled the role of mother. I think it's important to remember this is not only Mother's Day, but this is also Sunday. I don't know if my mom has gotten me anything. I'm looking forward to celebrating both Mother's Day and Sunday. Are there joys or concerns to share with the family this morning?
I have a concern this morning. Brad's mom, Bev Salmon, fell this morning, and she has a big knot on her head. Her knee hurts and her shoulder hurts. Her blood sugar was 67, which she fights with low blood sugar, and they're on the way to a Mother's Day visit to the emergency room. So I would appreciate your prayers, and we'll keep you updated. And it was so crazy this morning, I forgot to light the candle, so I'm gonna do that as I leave.
I have a concern. Mike Monahan and his wife have been ill for a few weeks now. We need our prayer.
Landon's dad this morning is walking across the stage to receive his master's in business administration at Purdue.
Hey.
All this while Landon was in the hospital, Ryan was being a bread earner, a Mr. Mom, and a caregiver. As his aunt, I am so very proud. And I think that your prayers had a big part in it. Thank you all.
I'd like for all of us to acknowledge Kaylin Craig, who's in our sound booth today. She works many a Sundays, so she does take a Sunday here to help us. But Kaylin is engaged and will have a wedding late July in Southern Illinois. Congratulations, Kaylin.
I have a prayer concern. Since Clara mentioned relative,
I won't be here next Saturday. I'll be in Fort Smith, Arkansas, University of Arkansas Medical School. My granddaughter will become a doctor of osteopathic medicine. After 13 years, she's been playing with this. She got 3 more years of residency. If I had buttons on my shirt, I'd be popping my buttons off. Margaret is home, got her home Friday. She's got a pain pump in, and tomorrow they will regulate. I think when she got it a week ago Wednesday, there was some morphine in it because she hadn't been on me. So it had to be something in it. But conference tomorrow with a specialist in Louisville and the pain management doctor here in Evansville to regulate her pain pump. Ask for prayers for this because the way I understand it, it's kind of more pain, let's put it that way. Just please pray for Margaret. Thank you.
My mom's little brother passed away on Thursday. He was much younger than my mom. It was a kind of a surprise to the family. I know that there was strong love in that family, and I feel my mom's pain. Let's gather our hearts and our souls together in prayer.
Live in charity and steadfast love. Live in charity, God will dwell
with you. Gracious and ever-loving God, we pause this morning to catch our breath, to prepare for a new week. We give you thanks for the beautiful weather. What a joy it is to step outside and breathe deep. We give you thanks for the love that we have experienced from our mothers, from those who have served as mothers, those who have been mentors in life, those who have advocated for us and protected us, those who have strengthened us and nourished us. We know that there is healing taking place in our community. We ask you to be with the doctors and the nurses, all the medical staff. We give you thanks for the celebrations. May is a time of celebrating accomplishments. We know that you celebrate with us. We give you thanks for the ministry that has taken place in the sound booth. It is a difficult and a hidden job sometimes. But we give you thanks for the ministry that Callan has provided to us. And we offer our blessing with yours as she moves into new opportunities and new life. We ask for your blessing on our bishop, on his cabinet, on the leaders of this congregation, and all those who carry out the ministry of this church, extending Christ into the community. all these things, Lord, and those things that we hold silent in our hearts, we lift to you in the name of Jesus, who continues to teach us to pray. Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, and the power, and the glory forever.
The joy of listening to a radio program called American Roots, and they had a lot of musicians on there who were singing songs about their moms and singing songs other people had written about their moms. Why do you suppose they were doing have that program on last night? No idea? Anybody? Because of Mother's Day. Very good. Okay, so I didn't come up during this flower presentation because I get to show a few pictures here. Okay, I'm going to share about a few moms in my family, and then Joe is going to share about some in his family. Okay, this is my mom. You want to hold that up? And yeah, good. My mom and dad having a special dinner to celebrate the end of World War II and his return from the Philippines. Turn around so that people can see. Okay. My mom was born in 1923. Her name was Audrey. She grew up one of nine children. She was the middle kid. And her family was musical. She played, they had a family band. She played saxophone and clarinet. And they played at the county fair and the state capitol. Okay, here is my mom's mom. Her name was Annie Larson. Grandma was born in 1898. She grew up Annie Larson. And she ended up being a farmer's wife with nine kids. I already said the nine kids. And so I wonder how she fed them all. Her sister was a school teacher, and so in the summer, the sister would come and live with the family too. So in all, there would have been 12 people in the household to feed every day and clothe. So she was amazing. She didn't have an easy life. And then there's her mother. You want to hold that one up? Her mother, my great-grandmother, was Ida Christina Larson Larson, born in Sweden. She grew up in a poor family. She was a servant in the household of a rich family until her sweetheart, who's in the picture too, her sweetheart was Eric Larson, and he convinced her to sail on a ship to America and live in America and marry him. You couldn't get on a plane then because there weren't planes then. So she was born in 1865. Okay, Joe?
So this is my mom, Sharon Leagers. Do you wanna hold this? So I'm one of five kids. I've got two brothers, two sisters. And between us, we have our own kids. We have, so she has 12 grandkids. And I was talking to her one time about how she got married when she was 21, and most of her 20s, 30s, 40s, and 50s have been dedicated to raising kids and grandkids and all her. I live the furthest away, and I'm only an hour away. Most of them are 10 minutes away, so she's always watching the grandkids. And I was like, gosh, what were you thinking, having five kids? I mean, you could have seen this problem coming. You would know you're going to be busy for the next 50 years of your life. And that anytime I say that, she reminds me, you're lucky I had five kids, because you're the youngest of five. So, and this is my grandma, Marjorie Rothert. And she lived in Holland, Indiana, about an hour from here, a small town of Holland, and she was the postmaster, so she worked for the post office, and her husband had a hardware store, and she helped with the hardware store. And this is my great-grandmother, Elsie Boozy, and she grew up on a farm, had nine kids. And I was asking my mom, because I never met her, I was asking my mom what animals they had. She said, cows, chickens, and peacocks. And I was thinking, like, oh, I wonder, do they keep pests away, or can you sell the feathers or eggs? Or what do peacocks do on a farm? And I asked her, and she said, oh, they're just cool. They're interesting. They look neat. So because she liked peacocks and how they looked, they had peacocks on the farm. Would any of you like to share anything about your mom or grandmother or anything you appreciate about them?
I appreciate that my mom takes care of us every single day.
I like that my mom has a garden.
I appreciate that my mom helps me do things that I don't know how to do, and we do lots of fun things together.
Very good. So Joe's going back to the piano while we will be ready to do an echo prayer. Are you ready? Let's be ready to pray an echo prayer. Dear God.
Dear God.
Thank you for hearing our prayers.
Thank you for hearing our prayers.
Thank you for nature's beauty.
Thank you for nature's beauty.
Help us take good care of ourselves.
Help us take good care of ourselves.
And each other.
And each other.
And we pray in Jesus' name. Amen.
In Jesus' name.
Amen.
Amen.
The reading this morning is 1 John chapter 5, verses 9 through 13. If we receive human testimony, the testimony of God is greater, for this is the testimony of God that has testified to his Son. Those who believe in the Son of God have the testimony in their hearts. Those who do not believe in God have made him a liar by not believing in the testimony that God has given concerning his Son. And this is the testimony. God gave us eternal life, and this life is in his Son. Whoever has the Son has life. Whoever does not have the Son of God does not have life. I write these things to you who believe in the name of the Son of God, so that you may know that you have eternal life. This is the word of God to the people of God.
Thanks
be to God.
Thank you.
At this time, I would invite the rest of our offerings. Gracious Lord, we give you thanks for the many blessings you have poured out upon us, and we return a portion of those blessings back to you now for the further service of your church. Amen.
Let us turn to number 714 in our Methodist hymnal and sing together, "I Know Whom I Have Believed."
Thank you.
Our scripture reading this morning comes from John's Gospel, the 17th chapter. I have made your name known to those whom you gave me from the world. They were yours, and you gave them to me, and they have kept your word. Now they know that everything you have given me is from you, for the words that you gave to me, I have given to them. And they have received them and know in truth that I came from you, and they have believed that you sent me. I am asking on their behalf. I'm not asking on behalf of the world, but on behalf of those whom you gave me, because they are yours. All mine are yours, and yours are mine. And I have been glorified in them. And now I am no longer in the world, but they are in the world. And I am coming to you. Holy Father, protect them in your name that you have given me, so that they may be one as we are one. While I was with them, I protected them in your name that you have given me. I guarded them, and not one of them was lost except the one destined to be lost, so that the scripture might be fulfilled. But now I am coming to you, and I speak these things in the world so that they may have my joy made complete in themselves. I have given them your word, and the world has hated them because they do not belong to the world, just as I do not belong to the world. I'm not asking you to take them out of the world, but that I ask you to protect them from the evil one. They do not belong to the world, just as I do not belong to the world. Sanctify them in truth. Your word is truth. As you have sent me into the world, so I have sent them into the world. And for their sakes, I sanctify myself, so that they also may be sanctified in truth. Here ends the reading of God's holy words. What is the mission of the church? What is it that differentiates the Christian church from any other social organization? What is it that makes a church distinct from, say, a country club or the YWCA? What is it that sets a Christian church apart from any other do-good organization? Is it the fact that it gives us a social activity on Sunday mornings? Because basketball and baseball would do the same thing. Is it simply the camaraderie of sharing common interests? Because a lot of people share common interests and camaraderie in a bar. Or do we gather to see what everybody else has been up to? There's nothing wrong with doing any of that. Is that what we're all about? I've been wondering over the past couple weeks about what does it mean to be a member of an organization? What is the incentive for joining the church? Or is there any? Why do people seem to drift in and out of church membership over the course of their lives? Is there any reason for a person to join the church? Is there a difference between being a member and simply attending? What is the mission of the church? I'm the pastor, so I'm supposed to urge you to join the church. Why? What is the church? What's the mission of the church? 7 weeks ago, we celebrated Easter, and over the past several weeks, we've talked about different ways of relating to God and to the church. I talked about left brain and right brain. I tried to incorporate some of the more touchy-feely aspects of faith, letting go of the harsh objective descriptions and explanations, and trying to just let go. We've also focused on some of the Psalms, the poetry, and the imagery of our faith. The Lord is my shepherd, I shall not want. We talked briefly about the early days of Methodism, about John and Charles Wesley, who always remind me so much of Frazier and Niles Crane. At various times, we talked about the quadrilateral, about scripture, tradition, reason, and experience. I blathered on and on about hymns by Charles Wesley. I told you about Brother Van Song. I'm going to teach that to you. Last week, we talked about how each of us experiences our relationship with God in different ways. I don't usually do sermon series like some preachers do, and I'm not really sure why. This is a conversation I've had several times with my clergy coach. I don't typically do a series of sermons, but I do tend to move sort of thematically through a season. I tend to be someone who will have, say, guest speakers all during Lent as a theme. And our theme during the Easter season has pretty much been the church. Brother Van Song, when you live in Montana, is the church. I promise I'm going to teach it to you. This has been the Easter season. And now we have come to the end of the Easter season. This is Ascension Sunday, the day when we look at Jesus as his body leaves the earth, as he leaves behind the promise of Pentecost. He rises into the clouds, and the angels say, "Why are you just standing there? Get busy. What are we doing here? Why do we stand gawking at the clouds? You know, look busy." What is the mission of the church? Why do we gather together? I think it might help to figure out first what the church is not. So if we can come up with a list of things that the church is not, maybe that'll help us see what the mission of the church is. I would say, first of all, that the mission of the church is not to destroy a person's self-confidence and emotional stability in order to make church membership the only remaining option. I think it's a reasonably common misconception that one of the duties of the Christian church is to point out to potential converts how depraved they are, how evil they are, how repulsive they are to God. For me, first and foremost, this is not the mission of the church. To destroy someone's psyche in order to draw them into the church is a blatant misuse of the concept of salvation. It's not necessary for the church to demolish the emotional or spiritual stability of a person in order to further the kingdom of God. What else is the church not? It's also not the mission of the church to feed the world. And that seems like an odd thing for me to say, especially in this church. This isn't to say that the church should ignore the hungry or the thirsty or the naked or the oppressed in the fulfillment of its mission. But it's rather to say that this is not the mission. If the mission of the church was to feed the world, why would it bother preaching morals and compassion? The world could be fed a whole lot more efficiently through pilferage and thievery. In fact, it's this very misconception that has led to the continual perpetuation of romantic heroes like Robin Hood. Ideally, the hungry will be fed, the thirsty will be satisfied, the lonely will be cherished as a result of the fulfillment of the church's mission. But that isn't the mission of the church. It's better than that. The world can indeed be a better place than that. The mission of the church is not to increase the wealth of either the leader or of the congregation. It's too bad that entire theologies have been built around the notion that what one gives to the church will be returned a hundredfold. It has caused ministries to be centered on a person's tithing as a means of investment. If somebody gives to the ministries of the church, it's almost like a passbook savings account, like laying up one's treasures in heaven via the offering plate. The mission of the church is not the increase of wealth. The mission of the church isn't even to be run like an efficiently run business. Surely the mission of the church is higher than that of a bank. Tithing is not an investment plan, and it's regretful that it has so easily become one. The mission of the church is not to be political. Dan. And again, let me be quick to point out that political involvement should never be denied to any person or organization. But that's not the mission of the church. Mahatma Gandhi once said, "Those who insist that religion has no place in politics either don't really understand politics or really don't understand religion." Religion certainly has a place in politics, but it's not the mission of the church to be political. Dan. This Dan, sorry. For whatever reason, the political force of Christian nationalism has begun to creep into both politics and religion. Christianity is seen as the dominant and superior faith tradition. This is distracting, I know. Christianity is seen as the dominant and superior faith tradition, and it's increasingly thought of as the tool to wield power in order to set a political agenda. Islamic and Hindu and Buddhist and atheist philosophies are subservient to Christian nationalism, and they are more and more considered to be moot. Everybody has a different idea about what the church should be doing and the power it should be using. How do we shepherd to people who disagree? What is the mission of the church? I have no problem with the church being political in order to fulfill its mission. And while it must certainly be said that religion by its very nature is political, the mission of the church is not to be political. So we started out with not grinding people into the ground so that they have nowhere else to turn. I decided the mission of the church is not to make money, and the mission of the church is not to be political. So if the mission of the church is not the downgrading of individuals to what they should not be, then it must be the uplifting of individuals to what they can become. If the mission of the church is not to make money, it must be to transcend money. It must be to go beyond what money can do. If the mission of the church is not to be political, it must go beyond what politics can do. Here's where I see the mission of the church. The mission of the church is to lift people up high enough that they can see the possibilities of what they can become, to see over the clouds of doubt, to see the kind of person that they can be, feeders of the hungry, satisfiers of the thirsty, cherishers of the lonely. The mission of the church is to provide a safe haven for dreams and possibility. If the church is uplifting enough and inspiring enough, it can affect changes within people to encourage them to feed the hungry without the need for arms, without wondering what kind of return they'll be getting on their investment. If the church can inspire dreams of possibility, the world can become a better place. It's the mission of the church to provide a safe haven, a sanctuary for dreams of what can be. It's the mission of the church to be that one place where one can imagine the best. The church is an organization of people who, with a perfectly straight face, staunchly celebrate the resurrection of a man once dead. If the church refuses to imagine the best, then what's the point? If this is not the mission of the church, this opportunity to dream and to achieve with an appreciation for God's relationship with us as a people, if that's not the mission, then you're right. We're no different from a bar or a country club or the YWCA. We as a denomination are struggling to rekindle our dream. Major changes are churning for the United Methodist Church. And still we hope to rediscover what it is that sets us apart from the rest of the world. And if it isn't that single phrase, godly possibility, then what's the point? With God on our side, and isn't that kind of the point? We can accomplish those things that sparkle. We can feed the hungry, even if all we have is 7 loaves of bread. We can raise up to the Lord a joyful noise. We can accomplish things that will give glory to the Creator, because all things are possible in Christ Jesus. The church is a place to find discernment of one's gifts for ministry. I believe that in making disciples of Jesus Christ, it's not enough to simply bring a person to their knees. It's equally important for the church to help a person stand up, to recognize their gifts in light of God's grace, to help equip that person for ministry, and then to commission them to go into the world. Go forth now into the world, into your community, to proclaim and to be the love of God. That's a commissioning. The church is not only where ministry takes place, but where ministry begins to gurgle and flow into the world like living water. In carrying out the commission of Jesus, it's not only important what happens at church, it's also important what happens because of church. It is the church, that organization which, with teary eyes and trembling voice, consecrates bread and grape juice to celebrate life itself. It is that church which calls us to greatness, to allow the world to imagine for itself the best of all possibilities. It is the mission of the church to celebrate the power of the divine in fulfillment of what can be, as exemplified by Jesus. This is the mission of the church. Anybody want to join? Let's sing a song.
As we endeavor to fulfill the mission of the church, let us be ever mindful of the need for Jesus to walk with us through the journey. Let us stand and sing 521, I Want Jesus to Walk With Me.
Forth now into the world, into your homes, into your community, commissioned by Jesus Christ to proclaim and to be the love of God. May you continue to be created. May you continue to be redeemed. May you continue to be sustained and nourished and blessed and held and loved and loved and loved and loved and loved and loved by God Almighty. And may peace abide among you. Amen.